Hello, dears. Welcome to our interview special with Spike the Duke Edney. In case that name is not familiar to you, Spike has been a key collaborator with Queen ever since he started playing keyboards and backing guitars with them on the Works Tour back in 1984. He was right there on stage with them at Live Aid, Wembley 86, and the tribute concert. He was integral to the We Will Rock You musical. He was in the Brian May Band, Roger Band's The Cross, and of course in Queen plus Paul Rogers and Adam Lambert. He's also worked with the likes of Duran Duran, the Boomtown Rats, and the Rolling Stones, as well as running his own group, Spike's All-Star Band, the SAS Band. Now, the internet was not particularly kind to us during this interview, so I'm afraid Spike's sound does occasionally drop out, but he was on brilliant form, and we had a really lovely, wonderful time with him. I'm very excited to share it with you. Do enjoy. Hello and welcome to a very special Queenpod. I'm here with Simon Lupton, producer Sam, and Sooz Kempner to talk to the one, the only, the mighty Spike the Duke Edney. Hello, hey, Spike.
Hooray.
Very happy to have you here on Queenpod. We're thrilled that you've given up your time to chat to us. I would start with, how are you getting on with your autobiography, please? Because I feel like you've got many stories to tell and I want to read them all.
Yeah, do you know, it's not a labour of love. I'm actually really enjoying doing it, but it's a never-ending deep mine of memories. And every time I sort of dig into something and start to put the pieces together and I look at dates and I look at things like tour itineraries and all that stuff, something springs to mind, and the story, and then one story opens up another avenue of other stories, and then I have to go and take care of all those. And it's a real case of I want to catalogue as much as I can remember, so that it's done, and then kind of select the best of it, or let an editor select the best of it for the book. I've got way too much for a book. But I've got COVID at Christmas.
Oh, and, no, I'm sorry, mate.
Well, you know, I mean, so did millions of others. But I noticed that my sort of concentration and energy level was greatly affected by that. And whereas I had a sort of plan to have it all done by about this time, in fact, I just seized up, because every time I sat down and started to write, I found myself, it was lackluster. It had no spirit, no vibe to it.
Yeah.
And I thought, I'm not ready to do this now anymore at the moment. I need to sort of get my mojo back, as we say. And it's my thought that I've got a month coming up now before the Queen tour kicks off. I'm in London at the moment, and I'm going back to America in a couple of days. And I've kind of set my sights on, I'm going to sort of buckle down and try and finish. But I'm in a real juicy period right now. I stopped just as I was talking about the 1986 tour. So when I was digging out all those
memories. Oh, wow.
So that's, it's a journey, actually. And it's one I've really enjoyed, but it's much more detailed, and I'm remembering much more than I would have expected to. So whether it's true or
that's
accurate,
amazing.
I'll be making it all up. I don't know.
It's not like you wrote any of it down at the time, right?
Took lots of photographs, though. Of course, diaries with dates and gigs in them.
Yeah.
I get a rough picture of how things hang together, you know. And although I was a bit wary at first of making it linear, you know, sort of month follows month, I'm not doing that exactly, but tour follows tour. And you know, there's no point in jumping around and starting with the Freddie Mercury tributes and then ending with the Works tour, when in fact it runs the other way around, you know, that section.
Yeah, of course. And there's a progression that comes from that.
Yeah. A natural progression and a natural meeting of people. And friendships are made and friendships are lost, and remarkable things happen and ridiculous things happen. And that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah. I don't want to put you on the spot, but just out of curiosity, Can you share any of these little stories that cropped up for you lately where you've been really entertained by what's popped into your head?
I don't want to give any jewels away because, but there's the, well, it's quite famous story now of my sort of introduction to Queen, because I wasn't a Queen fan by any stretch of the imagination. I admired them. I could tell that they were, because I didn't come onto the scene until 84, so that was the works. Yeah. And since sort of Killer Queen all the way through, I'd like their records, but I'd never been to see them. And I was a Steely Dan fan, and I like Earth, Wind & Fire and Stevie Wonder.
Right.
So my heart, my musical heart, was very much across the Atlantic.
In soul and...
Yeah, soul, really. I mean, through the 60s, I was a Beatles fan and Stones and all that stuff. But by the late 60s, early 70s, I really... kind of moved to, my taste had moved to America, and the 70s in the UK were all right by me. I mean, I liked a bit of Bowie and I liked a bit of Mark Bowler and I liked a bit of Queen. It was just like that, you know. So when the offer came through, are you interested in doing something with Queen? I went, yeah, okay. It was no kind of big deal for me, except that I wanted to work, and being a semi unemployed musician, it's always good to get off. So, I had to, I was called to go to Pembridge Villas, which was where the Queen office was in those days. It was a Georgian townhouse. So I went across there and I just assumed that it would be like most other auditions for professional musicians. You turn up and you're one of 200 people sat there waiting to get your 5 minutes. Now, the problem was I didn't know any Queen songs, had no clue. So I thought, well, this is going to be a bit bloody short and a little bit, they want to play some Chuck Berry or something. So I have to say I was quite sort of apprehensive walking up the road from the tube station to Pembridge Villas, and you knock on the door, it's quite imposing, and you go in there and there seems to be a ground floor of secretaries behind desks and gold records all over the wall, and a bit intimidating, to be honest. And they said, who I am, why I'm here. And they said, all right, upstairs. And I thought, okay. In my mind, it was upstairs was a studio with everybody sat there and the gear all set out. And
yeah,
but none of it. I go upstairs, it's more offices, and there's an office there with a door open. And so I sort of amble in, quite confused. And this rather portly gentleman in a brightly coloured shirt came in and he said, who are you? I said, my name's Spike and I'm here for the audition. He said, oh, okay, not impressed at all, showing nothing. And he said, my name's Jerry. Of course, Jerry Stickles is his name.
Wow. You
know who that is, right?
Stickles will see to that.
So I sit down and he says, right, have you got a passport? I said, yes. He said, have you got it with you? I said, yes. He said, give it to me. And he put it on a photocopier. And he said, are you available to travel between the months of August and, I don't know, September, November or something? I said, yes. He said, right. He said, okay, so next Monday, you will have a ticket and you will fly to Munich and start rehearsals. And I went, this doesn't really work like this, you know. This is where are the other 200? Maybe the other 200 guys are going to be there, and we're all going to. I said, this is quite strange. I said, what happens if I get out next Monday? If I get out to Munich and they don't like me? And he said, then on Tuesday you'll fly back.
How did Monday go? Pretty well.
The story is yet to be told, yeah.
Wow.
That was the first introduction.
Wow.
We watch the soldiers, we watch the sun, all the videos, for hours and hours. We hardly need to use our ears. Our music changes.
So I've got to ask, and then I will let you guys ask a question, sorry, but this sort of follows on, which is, what is it for you that that you feel clicked with these guys in such a way that you've ended up working with them pretty much ever since then?
It's a balance that you have to have when you're working with a ready-made unit. There are a lot of big bands around the world who take on extra players when they tour. I mean, the Stones do the same thing. And if you look around, as you know, U2 have an extra guy and News have an extra guy. It's a common thing. And every one of those people that do that job, unless they're a mate who's been around since the school days and so is included, if you're just hired and you come in cold, you have to listen to what's going on, and keep your mouth shut until somebody asks you for your opinion, because it's a very precarious thing for you to put your hand up and jump in with an idea, especially when the bands have very talented people in them, and you've got four talented people in Queen. They've got more than enough musical ideas to sort out what they need to sort out. They don't need the likes of an upstart like me coming in telling them what to do, except sometimes they do. Sometimes there's a musical impasse or a blockage or something, and then you just sort of got to ease the log jam and say, well, what happens if instead of doing that, we tried it this, or tried to do this, or tried to do that, or something different. And it's gauging when is the right time to do that. And sometimes I get it terribly wrong, and they say, for God's sake, shut up. Or other times they say, that's a terrible idea. Or sometimes they say, maybe we'll try that, you know. And so, and if, after a while, if they trust you and you get to feel the vibe of the band and the relationship between the four members, then you can gauge when it's a good time to suggest something and when it's a good time to go and have a cup of tea, keep out of it, you know. So, and I'm by the time I got to them, I was in my, so what was it, 84? How old was I?
Oh, 20. 21.
I was in my mid-30s, and I've been around the block a bit, and I kind of had that skill of knowing when it's best to shut up, you know.
Right.
When they really don't want your opinion.
yeah, of course.
These four walls are closing in. With what a fix you put me in.
Queen, you obviously started in the sort of mid to late 60s on this career path. What was your goal when you started out, and would sort of teenage you be pretty chuffed with how things have turned out?
To meet girls, obviously.
Sure.
That's why I switched from cricket to guitar.
Did it work?
I don't know, because I didn't do the cricket. I'm
very diplomatic answer.
But because of the time, and I really account myself as being so lucky to have had my being born in the 50s and having my teenage years in the 60s, was such a cultural explosion and revolution for young people, the music, you know, the style, everything, and to witness the changes from Cliff Richard and the Shadows through the Beatles, to the mods, soul explosion of Tamla Motown. It was just one thing after another. It just, you know, it just never ended. And it was fantastic. And I took that for granted. That's how exciting music was and would always be. And that was a roller coaster that I wanted to be part of. Mm. And it was, I had to find, I started out playing with schoolboy mates, and we had a schoolboy band from the age of about 12 to 14. Mm. And in fact, you know, they're all still alive and we're in touch. And the three of them actually carried on, even though I sort of quit after a couple of years because I felt the urge to do something else. I wanted to be in a band. Being in a schoolboy band, we only ever played at people's houses, friends' houses. Your mum. Right. Your mum would let you play. Yeah. And you played to a couple of neighbours. And that was about as big as it got. I wanted to walk on stage with a band that had a PA system and a van and people that had come in to see the band properly. And I got that bug by the age of about 17 when I found three guys who were exactly my year in a different school, but who were very, very talented. I suddenly realized that you had to work if you wanted to be out there with the good people, and you better improve. And it made me, drove me to improve and become better. And until the day when they gave me a go and let me play with them. And then they asked me to join them, which was, this was 1969. To me, that was it. I thought I'd climbed the highest peak possible. I was playing with the guys that I admired most. And then of course you've got to think about, you know, you leave school and then you think, well, I've got to make a living. What do I do? So I spent a couple of years pretending I was doing a real job in the civil service, but really I was just doing it to appease what I thought my parents expected of me. So leaving school and jumping straight into a van wearing flared trousers and smoking dope wasn't really a career path that I could offer. But joining the civil service seemed like a good sort of sop. So I did the civil service for 2 years, but really four nights a week, I was jumping into a van with my linen pants on. And then it was just the desire to get better, you know. Mm-hmm. So you start out copying the Beatles and the Stones, and then you move on and you're, musical ability grows, and then all of a sudden you're copying Chicago and you're copying Steely Dan, and there's a whole new degree, and Jimi Hendrix and whatever, it's a whole new degree of musicianship that you're aspiring to. If somebody can play this and make it sound brilliant, what do I have to do to copy that, you know? And that's all you're doing, copying, until then you realize that that's not enough, you've got to write songs as well. So so then you struggle to get your material together, and it's a constant ladder of improvement, you know.
I was wondering what shortcut you use with the band, because obviously they don't tend to use manuscript paper much, right? I don't know if you do actually that much, but I kind of suspect you will do for certain things, probably like We Will Rock You the Musical. But yeah. What's the language? How does it work? In actual fact, when you get together, how does that first bit of, okay, let's play Hammer to Fall and let's start playing that, is that just a language that exists and you just start
doing it? By the time you walk into a room and start playing a Hammer to Fall, you've been speaking that language for many years. And so when somebody says plays three notes or a chord progression, you need to be able to understand exactly what he's doing and play along with him. Now there are certain songs that's easy to do, so if you're playing a rock and roll classic, it's probably only three chords, four at the most. If you're playing Bohemian Rhapsody, you might want to sit around at home first and do a bit of homework. Yeah, I mean, so there, you know, there are degrees, and there are some bands where you could literally walk on stage and join in, but there are some bands where you must have done some preparation. Now, I don't read that great. I didn't have too much of a formal training because I hated what I was being trained to do. And it didn't sound like anything that was fun to me. So I ended up relying on my ears completely. So I could hear something, pretty much play it or understand what was going on, understand the musical language that was happening. And rock and roll is three chords and a bit more if you're lucky. And so once you've sort of established that in your mind, you sort of, you know, the main stuff is based on the blues, but you get the sort of European tradition that might come from a more classical background. But once you start learning to speak the language or you hear it, it just gets easier, you know. So,
right.
And what I will do, if somebody is playing something to me for the first time, I'll listen to it, I'll watch what their fingers are doing, and I will just write down my own shorthand of what's going on, you know.
Right.
So I can listen to a track and go, okay, this is the verse, this is the intro. I know that he's going from D to G to A to B minor. And then a chorus comes, and what is that? That's C, F, and G. And then we have a verse, and then a solo, and then two more choruses, and you've there you are, you've plotted it out. So then all you have to do is how are you going to start it and how are you going to finish it? And then you've got the plot.
Wow.
So do you just sort of keep all that information more or less in your head?
No, not at all. I've got a big fat folder full of scribbled, penciled notes, right, and with horrible bits of Sharpie scrawled all over the top where changes have occurred. But nowadays, of course, we have iPads, so it's all there.
Oh, okay.
But what you don't want to do is have somebody kick out your mains plug and your iPad resets in the middle of a gig. So
happened?
Yes, it has.
Oh, no.
Oh, in fact, my very good friend Jamie Moses, guitar player in my band, tells this horrific story of he got called to go in and do a gig with Mike at the Mechanics. He had done it before, but not for a few years. But because he'd done it before and he had all his stuff on the iPad, and there was no time to rehearse, and it was a festival, and there was no sound check. He walked on stage and he gave his iPad to the roadie who plugged it in, and it pressed the on button. It said, "Welcome to your new iPad."
Oh my God.
Into the language. And 2, 3, 4. And fortunately for him,
wow,
he did what all sensible people should do, is never rely on technology.
Yeah.
And he had a bag full of notes in his kit bag up in the changing room. So he bluffed the first song out of, you know, sheer bravado and memory, whilst he scurried up to the changing room to bring down all these moth-eaten bits of paper. And that's what we had, wow, moth-eaten bits of paper. And so I never go on stage now without knowing that somewhere...
A hard copy, yeah.
There's a hard copy. If the worst really does happen. But I don't need that for Queen, to tell you the truth. I mean, after 37 years, the only notes I need are for any changes we've made. Right. Or if there's something new been added for the sheer hell of it, you know.
Gotcha.
Or we've shortened something, or we've lengthened something, or... And this happens quite a lot, where we'll say, OK, we're going to do a fast version of To Hammer to Fall, or we'll do the slow acoustic version of Hammer to Fall, or we're going to cut out two choruses and medley straight into another song, you know. We do this to stop the boredom setting in, of course, but but we all have to know where we're starting from before we can make the changes, you know.
Yeah.
Waste no time at all. Don't hear the bell, but you answer the call. It comes to you as to us all. We're just waiting for the hammer to fall. Yes.
So it's interesting because the boys seem quite disciplined. There's a lot made of how they always rehearse, not like the example you just gave where there are some bands that don't even sound check. These guys always sound check. They always rehearse. They've always got a fairly... I mean, Live Aid was a very good example. I mean, I've seen you describe it as, well, we just put the biggest songs together into a set because that's what we thought we should do, which I thought was a brilliant point. But...
Seems so obvious.
What is that work ethic about? Do you feel that sets them apart a little bit from other bands?
They do have a good work ethic, but most bands, most established bands, hate to rehearse. Hmm. But they need to, because when you haven't done it for 6 months, you get rusty and the memory plays tricks. And so you may have played We Will Rock You 8 million times, but you've got to bang it through once or twice before you go on the road, just to make sure. And there's been some changes to that, and I'm not going to tell you what they are, but... Actually, that would be a good question. You know, what's changed?
What's changed in the intervening 2 years for the new tour?
Anyway, so they will rehearse... When something new is being done, or something's been dug out from the archives, they will. And sometimes when we do a special, and I use the, for example, do you remember the New Year's Eve gig, Big Ben? Mm.
Yes, yeah.
Queen,
yeah.
Big Ben, whatever. That took some work because it's all based around minutes and seconds before Big Ben goes off. So you don't want to be in the middle of an important song and the BBC turns you off while the Big Ben chimes and things like that. So
yeah.
we work on stuff like that. And coming up, we will do a few days together just to bang through the stuff before we go. The real rehearsal comes when we go to the production rehearsals with the stage and the lights and the video. All that stuff needs us to be accurate and on our game so that the crew and the technicians can make it all work. We don't waste too much time on digging stuff up. We can get up to speed quite quickly. Mm. It's all about what changes are going to occur, because we might turn around and say, we're going to change this, we're going to change that, and we change it instantly, play it once or twice, and move on, you know. So there's not much patience for banging things through relentlessly.
Sure,
you know?
Sure. Yeah, no, it's rehearsal with purpose. How does it feel for you up there, Spike? Are you just 100% focused on, you know, what the songs are doing and what you've kind of got, the job you've got in front of you, or are you like, hey, I'm up here playing with some really great musicians?
Yeah, I mean, all of that. But there are shows where I have to be focused because I'm looking for something that's going to happen. I'm waiting for a cue from somebody. I'm waiting for Adam to get to something, and he and I know what's going to happen next, but we don't know when it is until our eyes meet and we nod, and here we go. We do the thing that we were planning for. So there's a lot of that. You do have to keep your mind on the job. It's very easily, it would be easy to go off the rails, but it doesn't happen very often that we go off the rails, and we're fairly good at recovering, and I don't think most people would notice. The only time we ever have a problem, if there's a technical difficulty and everything blows up and stops, you know. So it's only happened once or twice, but somebody kicked the main switch and the power went off. And then sort of a minute later, it came back on again. And we just went, oh, two, three, four. And we just carried. We do need to have our wits about us. And yeah. I, for one, gave up drinking before the show because...
just like everyone else did, right?
Well, I'm not saying anything, but for me, I have things to where I have to start songs or do something that requires a precise decision and a precise action on my part for something, and or I have to be aware of some visual cue that is going on the screen, and to make sure that we are locked into that. And so I won't start until I see or hear something that's important.
And then you can start drinking.
Actually, I have my first drink before the encore because it's a.
Oh, good for you. That's about right.
It's We Will Rock You and We Are the Champions. And we all go on stage at the end. And there's always a lineup of tequilas or something or the local.
Yeah.
Or whatever it is. So then I think, well.
And yeah, you I'm can cut copy, loose a little bit.
It'd be pretty difficult for me to cut these up. So I'm,
you know. If I had those golden grains. Have my yesterday, I would wrap you in the heaven, but they let Diane on the way feel like me.
Like you are in a very exclusive club, really, of people that have performed on stage, you know, with Queen, particularly with Fred.
Yeah.
So you said at the beginning that you knew who they were, you respected them, but you weren't, you know, you wouldn't call yourself a sort of a big fan. But when you started performing with them on stage, you know, from your perspective, which is unique, i.e. on stage with them, did you get a sense of just sort of how good they were at working a crowd, at working a venue, and sort of make and putting on a show?
Very much so. I mean, the rehearsals, for the works, there was some new stuff to be attempted, new songs, i.e. Gaga, Break Free, Hammer, maybe one or two others. But everything else had been long established. So we did spend a bit of time figuring out, because they'd never had anything that had been led by the synthesizer up until this point. Mm-hmm. And Radio Gaga is very much so led by the synthesizer. Mm. So that was a new thing for them. And we worked hard at getting everybody comfortable with that. Because up until then, it had all been guitar led. Everything had been guitar led, all piano led from Fred or whatever. But when I saw them going through their paces of the stuff that they do, even in rehearsal, you know, I think it was Elton John said it's like a Ferrari, you know, it's a powerful engine just purring along, waiting to be gunned into life. And that really is what it's like. And I was not apprehensive, but I was focused and determined to get things as good as I possibly could so that they didn't stick me on the plane home. And so yeah, by the time we went on our stage in Belgium, that first gig, I was sort of 50% confident and 50% scared. And but the thing is, you know, they clicked into Queen mode from the offset, and Fred clicks into Fred mode, and that's something wondrous to behold, and to be that close to seeing what he did, how he was, not only the fact that he was magnificently talented, he loved what he did. And it really came out that he loved being up there, and he loved it. You know, the bigger the crowd, the more people, the better, darling, and all that sort of stuff. And that was a real thrill to witness, to feel like here's the Ferrari, and I'm in the baby buggy being towed behind. Because, you know, hang on for grim life. And I'm sure the two guys before me, Fred Mandel and Morgan Fisher, felt the same as well. Although there was a slight difference. By the time I came on board, I think it had been 2 or 3 years since the previous tour. When was the 81 or 82? Was
America, 82 was Hot Space. Yeah. So it'd been a good couple of years, and that was the last time they were a four-piece.
So in that period, these newer songs had come along, which had given my position more responsibility, the Radio Gaga and whatever. And also, I don't know if those guys sang, but I did volunteer to help out with the backing vocals, because Queen, of course, their vocals are, you know, everybody knows how magnificent their vocals are. But really, in the live show up until then, it was Fred and Roger who was captive behind a mic. John didn't sing hardly at all. And Brian would be off down the catwalk, or, you know. So you had one voice and one backup voice a lot of the time. And so me coming along added another harmony, which all of a sudden made things better. And I started to use the vocoder machine, which is what Roger had used on Radio Gaga, you know, the radio. I started to use that to fatten the backing vocals out. So when he and I sang on a few of the songs, I would add the vocoder. So all of a sudden we had what sounded like 3 or 4 voices.
That's amazing.
And nobody shouted at me for doing that. I just kind of did it because I thought it needed it. And I thought, I'll do this until somebody gets the ump with it. and they didn't. So that was good. And of course, over the years, things have changed in this current lineup. We've got 6 singers up there who could all really sing, you know. So even when Brian is doing his thing, we've still got 5 people at microphones, which is a big old deal. And I always regard the Queen backing vocals as almost as important as an instrument, because they add so much to the sound. So
I remember that little video that you put out of you guys rehearsing Man on Fire backstage just before the Outsider tour.
Feel like a man on fire, feel like a man possessed, feel like a man on fire, feel like a man possessed.
I give you the band.
think I watched that for like an hour straight, just on loop. And obviously, by the time I got to the gig, I was like, "Oh my god, it sounds so good!"
Yeah, I mean, it does sound good. And in recent tours, well, we have a little warm up thing. You've probably seen it on this. There's a documentary video thing of us backstage singing around the piano. And in fact, we've got a little medley of quite important vocal bits where everybody sings, and it lasts for about 5-6 minutes, and we do it every night. That's our gathering pre-stage thing. There's a piano in there, and once we're all assembled, we run that and we sing it, and then we walk out to the stage and we go on.
Sounds
so it's
like
always
your fine
to happen 7 minutes before showtime kind of thing. And there was something else. There was a review from a couple of years ago from someone in America, which said, and the backing vocals were suspiciously accurate. Roger was livid, absolutely livid about it, because he is very anti-augmentation when it comes to playing. You know, play it and sing it. Play the song, sing the words. That's the rule, you know. So to have it inferred that there was some jiggery pokery technical bollocks going on made me laugh. He still brings
it's
up.
It's actually
still,
flattering, isn't it, to a great degree, that your live sound is so strong they can't quite believe it?
Yeah, there is that. There is that. They can't quite believe it. But, I mean, when you've got you've got five people playing
you should be able
to tell.
From the same
pool at the same time, and six people singing. That's a monstrous sound. And if you've got a good sound system, it sounds devilish, you know. It sounds, and they do have a good sound system working for them. And we have good sound people and a great crew who help to make it sound brilliant and look fabulous. So, you know, we're very lucky. But it does fool people, because so many artists rely on electronic nonsense to provide stuff.
That's true.
And that's just not the way. I think everybody's too old-fashioned to worry about that. We don't do that.
Go on, Sooz.
Just thinking about all the times you've played as a part of these huge bands, what would you say is the most like a rock star you've ever felt going on stage? Or do you feel like that at every gig?
Well, I mean, I have to say, I think the sense of achievement that you've kind of scaled some kind of ladder or something is when you walk stage, when you did walk on stage at Wembley Stadium. Mm. I mean, we did things like Nebworth, but they're fields, you know, and you can't say, oh, played a field, brilliant, you know. but to walk on stage at Wembley was, I haven't played at the new Wembley Stadium, and people say that the sound there is crap, so I'm not in a hurry to get that. They really cocked it up by, the rumour is, and I could be wrong, so I'll put my hand up if I am, they said that they didn't take acoustics into consideration when they built it. That's the rumour, allegedly. And I was speaking to a guy in America recently who, his job was stadium acoustics, and he helped design a stadium in Germany, and but they built it according to the acoustic properties to get the best you could out of it. Now, would it have been so hard to have done that in our national stadium, which is famous for all shows? I mean, it just seems so short-sighted when you think of what's happened there performance-wise. And I think it was George Michael who opened, did the first gig when the new Wembley opened, and everyone said it was horrendous, the sound. Well, it was too quiet, and it was wishy-washy and whatever. But I am only repeating a spurious rumour.
What you've been told.
I have no proof that that is true. But, do you know what one of the greatest moments for me has ever been? When we were doing... this is with the SAS band, Spikes All Stars. We were doing a Nelson Mandela birthday party at Radio City Music Hall.
Wow.
and with an all-star lineup, and we had Aretha Franklin and you know, loads of great people. But also on the bill was my personal hero, Stevie Wonder. Now, I knew that he wasn't going to come and do the gig with us because he would only ever work with his rhythm section or whatever.
Okay.
So we were doing the sound check, and we were Cyndi Lauper and all these people banging on stage, two songs off, you know. Sound checks, like those things, are conveyor belts.
Yeah.
You don't even play the whole song. You play the beginning, cut straight to the end, off, next, you know, and we've got no time for diva behaviour. Anyway,
gotcha.
Stevie Wonder, they said, Stevie is going to use his band and everybody's going to leave the building. And I said, well, I used a very colourful Anglo-Saxon phrase and said, yeah, well, I'm the band leader and musical director of this gig. I'm not going anywhere.
Mm.
And I thought, I wonder if I can get away with that. And they said, oh, okay.
So Simple as that.
me and my guys went and sat down in the third row in Radio City Music Hall and watched Stevie Wonder jam for an hour with his band.
Aww.
We were the audience. And I can honestly say it was the most exhilarating thing to watch because they were just messing around, and he would play verse and a chorus of something, and then he'd stop and he'd start something else, and he'd jazz, blues, something of his, something of somebody else's. It was just a kaleidoscope of wonderful musical tidbits that all joined together for that hour, and we all looked at each other and said, that's the best concert any one of us has ever been to.
Wow.
And it was our position as the musicians on the show that allowed us to witness that. Nobody else did. And when it came to the actual gig, Stevie did his set. He played like 30 minutes or something. And right at the very end. And because of the the actual physical thing of getting on and off the stage, we all just stayed in our position. So I'm sat at my keyboard. To my right, down a little bit, is Stevie at his keyboard. So I'm just basically looking over his shoulder, and I'm sat watching. And he starts playing Happy Birthday to you, his song, Nelson Mandela. And I'm thinking, oh God, I could play this. And and his bass player, Nathan Watts, who's been with him forever, big giant guy he is, and bass looks like a toy in his hand. And I'm looking at Stevie and I'm looking at Nathan, and Nathan's looking at me, and then all of a sudden he goes, go on then. And he let me join. And of course it was in D flat, which is the worst possible key. that's probably the most rock star-y moment.
Wow.
I mean, I've come off jet planes and stuff like that, but private planes and whatever.
I love that. I mean, I've literally seen you on stage with Freddie shagging his own microphone stand, rubbing his back up against you, and you're like, yeah, I was sat in the third row watching Stevie Wonder all to myself. Most rock and roll moment I've ever had. That's so beautiful. That's a true musician's answer, that.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, I mean, all that Fred stuff, I mean, it happened so long ago. So, it comes back to me when I see, they show the video every now and then. I thought, yes, he really did do that, didn't he? He did jump on the piano and play along.
Yeah.
They showed the Freddie tribute the other night, and with all the greats, Robert Plant and Lionel Richie and all that stuff, and that was a pretty special moment. But it was so exhausting.
That was the first ever gig I ever went to in my life.
Oh really? Yeah. Wow!
It was one of the most amazing. I mean, it's still so vivid for me that day. Absolutely, it was the first time I saw you live as well. Not the last, but the first. That was a special day.
That was a whole special week because that seemed like an enormous mountain. We had there's a great shot of we're up in, was it Pinewood or Elstree or somewhere, I don't know, and you've got David Bowie, Elton John, Annie Lennox, George Michael, all sat there like a doctor's waiting room waiting to do their thing, and no histrionics, no diva behavior, no egos, exactly. It was fantastic for that, and And there's some great moments in that show. I mean, you forget how many great moments there are. Yeah. And it looks...
It's madness. I mean, you had loads of them, for goodness sake. It was absolutely incredible. It was, I still to this day, I'm like, oh my God, I got to see Spinal Tap play live. I got to see, you know, Extreme knock it out of the park with their crazy medley. And then once you guys got on stage, just seeing singer after singer fit in and trying to get my head around. I mean, you guys made it look incredibly easy. And it's only recently, because of Simon's documentary series, that I found out you weren't even sure if Axl Rose was actually going to turn up on stage or not.
No, not at all. We didn't know what would happen. And I was thinking, who's going to sing this bit if he doesn't bother to walk on stage? Because I don't think Elton was prepared to do that bit. Or maybe he was, I can't remember. And maybe Elton was going to join in. Because there was all this controversy, some nonsense, the papers were trying to make a deal. There was a feud or something weird going on. But actually, you know, it was all nonsense. And Axl was magnificent. And that performance, of course, cemented Guns N' Roses in Europe.
Yes,
that really opened up their career, and they took off from that. And all from wearing a leather kilt and spinning
around.
That'll
do. You know, I mean, that'll do for us Queen fans.
There's a lovely moment in the tribute concert where Brian introduces you to the crowd and sort of refers to you as the unsung hero.
I'd like to introduce you to an unsung hero who's been helping us out for very many years, and I have no idea what we would do without him. On keyboards, Mr. Spike Edney.
Sort of now, more recently, having seen you at work with, you know, particularly with Adam, but also, you know, with Roger on his solo tour recently, they really have come to rely on you almost as a musical director, haven't they, to sort of kind of help pull it all together and sort of keep it moving forward in terms of corralling the band. Is that something that you've grown into, or...?
It's more a case of being like a musical stenographer. I'm taking notes and remembering to... And I remind everybody, they don't need musical direction in the pure sense of the word, because they're Queen, they know what they want.
No.
Sometimes they need reminding of what they want. I'm like keeper of the keys in a way, and so I'll turn around and say, we've done this five different ways. We've done it, you know, like this, like that, and like that. What do you want to do this time? Are we coming up with a new way, or are we going to steal the work from 1978, or like that? With Roger, it was a bit different. I did have to do more there, because his songs from the album, The Outsider, of course, had never been played live. So there was no template to look at apart from the original studio recordings. And sometimes the original studio recordings, you can't just take that and do that live. You need to tweak it, you know. You need to find out what's the strengths of the song and what needs boosting and how do we make that work. So point of view, yeah, a lot more on that. But with Queen these days, I'm the man with the stopwatch.
The Outsider tour was amazing. You pulled together an extraordinary band for that. I think Tyler Warren and Tina Keys both stood out enormously. And in fact, Simon, you know, when Spike was introduced on stage at the tribute, we all knew exactly who you were, Spike. Like, we were all like, yes, he's an official member of the band as far as we're concerned. So that's what that cheer was about. And I think that has sustained, actually. I've seen you guys live every chance I've had since then. And that has really sustained. And I think Neil Fairclough on bass has kind of settled in very nicely with the band as well. But Tyler and Tina both really popped out. I thought what they brought to the band musically was amazing. I got to see Rocket Prime Jive live, which made me very happy. But I also noticed, like, you were doing things like you introduced a whole new keyboard element to Radio Gaga that made it sound utterly fresh and amazing. And I'm just wondering where those little choices, where those little moments of, let's put a new sheen on this, like kind of the rock out version of Somebody to Love, those kind of moments, where how they come about.
Well, I mean, basically, it's boredom sometimes. And you think, well, we've done this like this for so long, and so is there anything, is there a new way of approaching it? And sometimes there is, and sometimes there isn't. And but the good thing about Roger's tour specifically was, because I don't think he toured for a very long time, had he?
When not a solo it? Tour, no, he hadn't done Electric a solo Fire. Tour for a
donkey's years ago, wouldn't it? So we were, it felt like we were actually, it was a fresh canvas in a way. And I had conversations with him. I said, look, Rog, you know, we have decisions to make here. You've got how many solo albums has he done? Any idea?
Eight?
Nine, and then there's like three cross albums.
Yeah.
And
plus the two before that, plus Electric Fire. Electric Fire. I think we're on about Happiness. Eight now, possibly nine.
Yeah, right.
So there's a lot of material there. And the fans that know those albums all have their favourites, but you can only do so many songs in a show. I said, so we're going to decide. So we had lists, and these lists ran for a few weeks of definites, probables, maybes, and then dustbin, you know. Every few days I'd call him up and go through, and he'd had time to think about songs that he wanted to do and how many songs. We didn't do every song from the album, did we, outside of there were a few that we didn't do. Once we brought it down to about 25 songs, then you've got to figure out what order you're going to do them in. When we gathered for the first time in the first 2 days, fortunately, the quality of the musicianship is such that although Christian Mendoza and Tina were new,
they took
direction very well. So I called them as soon as we knew that they were going to be on board, and I said, this is what we expect. I expect you to know how these songs go. I don't want you to come in and start scratching your head. Even if it's just the fact that you know what's a verse, what's a chorus, and what are those changes. We'll worry about the twiddly bits later. Let's just be able to get together and bang them through. Warts and all, as we say. Well, you know, you're not worried about perfection, you're just worried about and we played every song in some kind of form within 2 days.
Wow.
Not very well particularly, but at least we had a feel. And then Rog listened to it and we discussed, and we said, well, this one is going to be great. We can tell this one's going to be great. That one, not so sure about. Doesn't seem, you know, something's wrong with it. And you have to just whittle stuff out. So there is a lot of thought going into it. And then once we knocked it down to about 20, we said, let's work on a running order now. Let's choose how we're going to start and how we're going to finish. So that's what we did. It has to be Strange Frontier to start. The way it opens, it allows itself to grow, and it kicks off. They all know it, and it's a great way to go. And then when we know what we're going to end with, And when we know what we're going to end the set with, I said, so now we're just going to figure out, well, where are we going to have a toilet break?
Yeah, right.
And so Rocket Prime Drive was the old folks going off the station.
Well, Tyler went to town.
Tyler took one for the team. Brilliant.
I love that little moment he had where I think he finished Strange Frontier and kind of went, I can't believe you guys know that. It's such an old song. Here's an even older one, and you ripped into Tenement Funster. And I'd never heard that live. And I was like, oh, I just looked at Simon and went, oh my God. I was there on the last night at Shepherd's Bush Empire, which was one hell of a gig. Yeah, that was a very, very special night.
They were all great, you know. I mean, I have to say, I think that the band gelled so well that we didn't suffer any bad gigs. We had so much fun doing that. I don't know if there's plans to do any more Outsider, but I really hope it does happen. So,
So do I. I just, you know, I've always loved, I've sort of had this base rule of getting to see you and any mix of Brian and Roger is always excellent. Just great musicianship.
Background is trained as a classical singer and then trained in musical theatre. I trained under Stu Morley, in fact. So I was wondering what your experience was of playing in the We Will Rock You orchestra pit.
Well, at first, I was not very keen on doing it because you have to be far more disciplined than I'm prepared to be in a West End musical. And Jim Beach called me when I was in California and said, we want you to be in the band. I said, why? This is a whole different thing. The West End is a whole different animal when it comes to the musicians and what's required. Mm. And I said, my reading's not that great. And he said, well, actually, we want you to be sort of the rock element and to make sure that things don't get too wishy-washy, turn into, we don't want this to turn into Cats, you know.
Yeah.
Which is, I'm not decrying that, that's something that people appreciate. Yeah. So I said, well, I'll do it for 6 weeks.
Right.
So I went along, and of course, all these songs that I knew had been written out for three keyboards. And I thought, well, barely enough work for one, let alone three. But anyway, this is what was decided. And it was all written out. And for me, I was slightly perturbed that some of that stuff, it's all about the feel, you know. So you play the chords, but it's the feel that really counts. And I was concerned that it was being overshadowed by the pinpoint accuracy of the music notes. Mm-hmm. It took a while for me to settle into it, and also following a conductor was new. Mm-hmm. But I thought to myself, I need to learn something here. This, you know, don't fight it, just go with it. And every now and then I would say, you know what, this is not really how it goes. You know, they don't do it like that. And once or twice, I said, this is how we do it in the theatre. And I thought, don't like that. Unfortunately, Brian and Roger would come in and hear it. And they go, what's wrong with that? It doesn't go like that. And thank you.
I bet they listen to them.
so that was quite good. And then the 6 weeks was up. And I said, right, I'm off, I'm done. And they said, no, we want you to stay. I said, no, I can't do this. Because up until then, we'd done every single show, which was like 8 shows a week.
Mm-hmm.
And how I explained it was, imagine if you sat down at 9 o'clock every morning and you wrote a letter that was going to take 2 hours, and at 10:30, you would be at a certain full stop on a certain sentence, and at 11 o'clock, you would be doing a certain character. And you did that 8 times a week. Mm. That's what it felt like to me. There was only a little bit where you could have a flourish of your own, but pretty much it was this. Mm. It has to be like that. Oh, I understand that. I'm not decrying it, but for me personally, that was kind of against everything that I'd grown up doing. And so I thought it's a different, that's why I say it's a different animal, it's a different approach. And there are people who absolutely respond to that. And a few of the guys there got it and understood that. And I was squirming inside thinking, I can't bear this. Mm. But they said, okay, well, you've reached a point now where you can put depths in. You can, I said, what? And you can have appoint people to stand in for you. All you got to do is train them up. And so I trained up about 15 guys. I kept half of the keyboard population of London working for the next 14 years because I could only bear to do like two or three shows a week.
Right.
And then I would go to California for 5 months.
Mm.
And I was like, I had like a spreadsheet and I'd put people's names into it and I shared it in, right? So Fred's on Monday, Joe's on Tuesday. And it didn't cock up, I'm glad to say, apart from once or twice, but nobody turned up.
Right.
And I had to leave the pub and rush over there. But apart from what it went through, and I grew to enjoy it immensely, actually. And the camaraderie, and Stu, when he came on board, he was like third conductor, I'm not sure. He had a great touch and a great way of dealing with everybody. And I have to say that after those first sort of like couple of months, it didn't feel like a chore anymore. I actually felt like I was a bunch of guys. We had a great vibe together, and we'd go and have, well, we did matinees, we'd walk around and have dinner. And then there was always the intermission up in the band room, and there was always, fun being had, jokes.
Yeah.
I think we even had a lottery syndicate going at one point. So I did enjoy it. Would I do it again or do another one? Definitely not. Never in a million years. My time is over for that. It requires younger, more attentive people to do it, not me.
This is what you wanted, this is what you're going to get!
Interested in what it was like coming on board with Queen, with Freddie being such an unusual pianist. Was it quite a strange thing to have to slot into yourself, or was it no different to slotting in as keyboard player on any other band?
Well, a bit of both, really. Keyboard player on other bands, I didn't have to copy too much. Well, I would listen to the records and glean what was going on or the live. But with Fred had a unique style of playing, his sort of European classical style, which he adapted into rock and roll. And I was quite fascinated by that. So when he showed me Seven Seas of Rye, and I went, hey, that's a bit hard, isn't it? And he said, wait till you get to the second chord, it's even harder. So I kind of made it my job to try to adapt me to him, his style. I wasn't going to force my style on his work. He wrote the bloody things, after all. The least I could do is give it a good go to make it. And in fact, a couple of tours ago, Brian paid me a huge compliment, and he said that he was backstage changing during one bit at the end of his guitar solo or something. He said when you started off, whatever it was, he said, I thought it was Fred playing. I thought, oh, actually, that was a really nice thing to say, and I took that as a compliment. And pay respect to the man and the music, really. Do the best you can to make it. Nobody cares what my version of that is. They want to hear it like they hear it,
So one of my favourite albums of all time is an album by a band called The Cross. Oh. It's called Mad, Bad and Dangerous to Know.
Oh.
I think it is an absolute masterpiece. I don't think there's a single track on there I don't love. I mean, I have listened to it to death.
I'm
And it's such a departure from that, from Shove It as well. Like, there was a real evolution to that band. Can you talk to us a little bit about what was going on around the making of Mad Bad and Don't You Know? Because I think it's extraordinarily underrated, that album.
Yeah, what a shame, because I thought it was a great record too. And I even like the follow-up, Boo Rock. I thought that had...
Yeah, it had a lovely sound to it as well.
The truth be told, that the first album, Shove It, was about 80% written and recorded by Roger. I had a little bit of involvement with it. And it was as he got to the end of the recording process that he realised that he wanted to have a band.
Right.
So the idea of The Cross occurred to him as he was doing the last one or two tracks. Now, we ended up playing on about three songs, I think.
Cowboys and Indians, and yeah, there were a few tracks in there.
A bit of Shove It, I think.
Yeah.
I can remember doing or playing all those sample, you know, very much sort of, when was it? Late 80s, was it? 88, 89?
I think early, yes. Very early 90s.
90s, yeah.
So everybody was doing the sample thing, the James Brown, and yes. I sampled Queen in there, found out it was illegal. I was just having fun. So Rog said, now I want to tour this as a band, and I'm going to call it a band. And so that was done. And I think, but the guys did get to play on a couple of things. So, of course, we took it on the road, had a lot of fun with it. Everybody slated it. You know, all the critics slated it, hated the very idea that Roger should have success with another musical thing. And we were deeply unfashionable. And then we started to combine songs. So, you know, all of a sudden, Pete's got Liar.
Beautiful song.
My love said she'd be the one. Now I know, baby, you're a liar. Oh. And you're a liar. A liar. But I'm still burning with desire. With the look of a panther. Lost in the jungle. Now I can't help myself again. I can't help myself. Baby, you're alive.
What did I do? I did something so gross.
Were you Better Things? Was that you? Or was that?
No, that was Clayton.
That was Clayton.
Clayton wrote Better Things. I wrote, is it Dirty Minds? Is that on that? Dirty Minds?
No, Passion for Trash was on with there. Dirty and... No, that's okay, on Blue Rock, I think. Dirty Minds. Closer to you.
Yeah.
Just to get closer to you.
Yes, and there was and of course the opening track,
Power to Love.
Yeah, Power to Love. That was Pete.
Right.
And
Top of the World Bar as well.
Top of the World Bar. Yeah, direct from James Cagney. You know.
Mm.
And some of that stuff. That stuff was written at Mountain in the studio, you know. So we would, and everybody did. Was Passion for Trash on that?
Passion for Trash was on Passion. That. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That was Josh. Absolutely. His demo. That was really good. He sang that really well. I was trying to push him to be the vocalist on the track, and
really?
We decided. He wrote it, and it really had something. I really like that. So yes, there were some great moments, and it was an album, a real kind of. A good sort of collective vibe making that record, and I thought this is really something going on here. And it just when the Berlin Wall came down, so there was a real sort of feeling of something happening or something. And of
I
course,
found my copy in Germany actually. Yeah, I was out in Germany and found it there. I didn't know it existed. I was like, oh my god.
The usual thing happened. We released it, and they got a big thumbs down from the reviewers, that's the press. Sure. But we did a great tour, and that was ended up being the final tour, I think, wasn't it, that tour?
I think so, yeah.
I don't know if you ever toured the Blue Rock tracks.
We didn't tour the Blue Rock, did we? No. Think so.
Amazing
it's
album.
It's a great band live. I thought they were great.
I think on that album, more than, you know, that's the most distinctive... you know, like a member of Queen has gone and formed a band, and that is a proper band, and they are all gelling as writers and performers and creating. I mean, every single track on that album is distinctive.
So you're the guy that likes it.
I'm the guy that's bought all of the copies of it. No. I've entered distractions with our listeners. It is loved. It is loved out there. I can tell you that much.
Power to Love was a great track.
Oh, and just the album cover's gorgeous. Like, the whole thing is fantastic. Yeah. I just picked it up on vinyl, and it sounds gorgeous all over. Old Men's on there.
Final Destination.
Like, it's such a beautiful version of that track as well. I do like the remix that he did on a later album, but like I say, I'd listen to every single one of those tracks as much as I have done any Queen album, for sure.
Heaven for Everyone was on Shove It.
That was on Shove It.
Shove It, yeah.
My preferred version of that track as well, actually.
Girls!
We love it!
Cars!
We love it!
Like, obviously, there are a lot of Queen fans out there who are chomping at the bit to get to see Queen and Adam live again. What treats have you got in store for them? What can they expect from the tour?
Playing the right chords and singing words.
No, you've got to do better than that, Spike. Playlist, please.
I can't actually answer that question because
you're not allowed to.
This would just have been those decisions haven't been made yet. But
all right.
If you think about this tour should have happened in March 2020.
Yeah. Exactly.
So it would have been an extension of what happened in the Far East just before that, with a couple of things changed, because there are songs that we play in the Far East that don't get played in Europe, only because they're I Was Born to Love You or something, or but who knows, maybe they will be included. But what I'm going to say is look at any footage of Australia, New Zealand or Japan from February 2020, and that will be the basis of the show.
Sure.
There could be some surprises, but I won't know that until a month's time, when somebody will either tell me they want to do something different, or when we walk into the rehearsal and somebody goes, hey, what about if we do this?
Have you got a deep cut track that you personally wouldn't mind having a sing its way onto the playlist?
No, I think because I'm not a Queen fan, I don't know. A lot of those songs I've never heard before. Like, I quite like It's Late, so I like it when we do that.
Yeah, yeah.
And Stone
Cold Crazy, stuff like that, when that comes in, does it?
Stone Cold Crazy, well, I'm not really in that because there's no room for keyboards. I can go off for an old man a toilet break when that's on.
All right, so write this down. Sooz wants My Melancholy Blues, okay? I want Dragon Attack. Those are the only two things that you need to write down, Spike.
But we've done Dragon Attack on previous tours.
Yes, I know. And imagine how well that went. Do you remember how well that went? When it went better than all of their other songs put together, if you think about it. So I did. I saw it at the Apollo and I burst into tears. I was sat next to Jackie from the Queen Club at that point. And I lost it completely, to be honest.
Was it in the show that we did in the Far East, Dragon Attack? I don't know.
I don't know.
Oh, well, if it was in the show that we did in the Far East, it might be in. Who knows?
We want that to happen.
The joy, you see, there's always a surprise, and it could be that we get into there and we start rehearsing the songs, and somebody says, "Oh no, not that one. We don't want to do that." And then something different will happen. So that's all I can give you, really, because that's all there is.
My very last question for you, Spike, is: what's your hot tip for surviving a Scrabble match with Roger Taylor, Freddie Mercury, John Deacon, and Brian May?
No, you.
That's a very good answer. That is a very, very good answer.
That's a good answer for life in general, I think.
It's true. Thanks so much, Spike.
Thank
You've been amazing. Thank you for spending this time with us. All our listeners are going to be so happy.
Lovely to meet you.
Really lovely to meet you. Cheers, mate.
All right, all the best. Bye-bye.
This has been the Queenpod, a Seven Seas Films production, edited and produced by me, Sam Easton. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram, and stay in touch by emailing queenpod@thequeenpodcast.com. Thanks for listening, and see you next time.